And if you do have any questions during the talk, the speaker has already told us that he wants questions, but you might have to like raise your hand because he can't see you.
Or that address is the Zoom for the talk. If by any chance you want to log in and you know watch the slides on your laptop, just mute because otherwise there'll be feedback.
Yeah.
All right. And
but yeah, you know, another question. During or after the talk. And again, there's no time limit. And if you finish it before 6:30, that gives you lots of time to like walk around your
don't scare him.
You can see our beautiful campus with the views. You can talk about asymptotic analysis until then. You can check in your hotel. All right. It's only a 10-minute drive.
If there are people that need ride, please see either Max or Norm or me or Adam, you know, anybody, just let us know. All right. And with no further ado, I want to introduce our keynote speaker, the Hardin from Vanderbilt University. Unfortunately, Doug, until maybe a couple of days ago, was coming in person, but was prevented from traveling and was kind enough to present this on Zoom. Nobody likes Zoom talks, but unfortunately we have to adhere to this format. Doug, the floor is yours.
Okay. Yeah, let me extend my apologies for a Zoom talk. I really tried to get out of it, but here we are. So I've had some health issues come up that prevent me traveling right now. When I was designing this talk, I really wanted to, there are certain methods that come through a variety of problems I'm interested in, especially packing energy and then more recently polarization that are called linear programming bounds. And there have been some recent, really high profile results that I wanted to at least describe, particularly Marina Viazovska's work showing the optimality of the E8 lattice. And it's really a beautiful area where somehow analysis problems that seem completely removed from any geometry knows the geometrical algebraic structures in certain dimensions, and it's surprising. Okay, so also currently this much of this work is with this group, Peter Boyd-Velinkov, Peter Dragnev, Ed Saf, and Maya Stoyanova. And currently we're really excited about this new direction of polarization. And as I was writing the talk, there's just no way I can include this, not in Finnish. So we'll talk about packing and energy. And Peter, I'm sorry, I'm not getting the polarization. Peter Dragnev has really been the engine behind this polarization work. So I'm sure if you get him started talking, he will give you a lot of information. Okay, now on a Friday afternoon, I'm gonna start out with pictures, and then I'm gonna try to get some math in, and then go back to pictures. So, but please ask questions, and just ask them verbally, and then whoever has the microphone can transfer them to me. I'd rather not watch the chat, but I would very much appreciate questions. Okay, let me start a long time ago. Sir Walter Raleigh asked Thomas Harriot to determine how best to stack cannonballs. And so this becomes the problem of packing balls or spheres in three dimensions in the most efficient way, that is, that occupy the smallest amount of space. Now, what we call the sphere packing density or optimal sphere packing density, delta D in RD, is the most efficient way of stacking, of arranging non-overlapping balls of equal radius. And by that, we mean that we cover the maximum fraction of space. So that would mean we'll get the maximal number of balls in a particular large region. So more precisely, what we mean by that is we'll need to take some large set, like a ball or a cube, and then scale it up. And then as the scale goes to infinity, evaluate what fraction is in our sphere packing. So a sphere packing consists of a union of a collection of congruent, non-overlapping, and I'm going to say open balls. So non-overlapping is the same as just non-intersecting. And then the density, or particularly the upper density, is what you get by computing the fraction of an extremely large ball that's covered by the balls in your packing divided by the volume of the whole ball. Yes. And then if you soup over all packings, that gives you the maximal packing density. And by the way, you don't need to set what the there's kind of a scale invariance here. That means we don't really need to specify what is the radius of the balls. We just need that they all have the same radius. Also, we'll need later on, we'll need the volume of the d-dimensional ball in of radius r, and that will be this factor. That's what I'll call beta d. That beta d is the volume of the unit ball. So the ball of radius r in d dimensions is beta d r to the d, that constant. For many of the optimal packings, these will be lattice packings. And so let me first of all just get a little note, some ideas and concepts related to lattices. So for me, by a lattice, I mean the integer linear combinations of a collection of a basis for RD. So one way to write that is if you have a invertible square matrix A, you apply it to integer vectors of length D, then all possible linear combinations with integer coefficients form the lattice. The canonical or the easiest fundamental domain of this lattice, if you take RD mod lambda, is to take the parallelotope you get by applying A to vectors of length D whose coefficients lie between 0 and 1. And that we'll call it's, of course, there are many other fundamental domains. In any case, it's easy to see that the covolume of lambda is the determinant of A, and that will in fact be the same value for any measurable fundamental domain that you pick. Another parameter is of a lattice is the minimum length vector in the lattice, which we'll call R sub lambda. Well, minimum non-zero vector in the lattice. And then if you have a lattice packing and the minimal vector is R lambda, that means by translation invariance that the distance between any two points in the lattice are separated by at least R lambda. So if you form, take the balls of radius R lambda over 2, that forms a sphere packing. And in this case, it's easy to see that for a lattice, you're going to have on average one vertex, one point per fundamental cell. So the packing density, the density of a lattice packing is given by the volume of the ball of radius R lambda over 2 divided by the co-volume. We'll also be interested in more generally endpoint lambda periodic packings. So in this case, we have a set of generators, omega n, and to keep things distinct, I'm going to insist that these are n distinct points in the fundamental domain. And then you take all lambda translates of that, and that infinite collection of centers will form an endpoint lambda periodic configuration. And then, so if the set of centers are that, we'll say that the packing is an endpoint lambda periodic packing. We're also going to find it convenient to consider the H energy of such a periodic configuration of points. And we'll come back to this in just a minute. And so right now, I don't want to get too technical, but what we're doing is for each point, xi, in our generating set, we'll take h of y minus xi and sum over all points y in the configuration except for xi. So sometimes h might blow up at the origin. So anyway, h of 0 is we're going to avoid. And right now, I don't want to give technical conditions about when this is going to be well defined. But as long as we don't have infinity minus infinity, this will be our energy, okay? And in particular, we can use this to characterize when, yes, go ahead. Is there a question?
No, go ahead.
Okay. So if we have a sphere packing that is a periodic, if we have a periodic sphere packing with radius r over 2, so all the centers are separated by at least r, and the centers are given by this periodic configuration, then we have a sphere packing if and only if the HR energy, where HR is this function that's the characteristic function of the unit ball. In other words, it's 1 if the norm of X is less than R, and 0 when the norm of X is bigger than or equal to R. I should say that throughout, the norm of X is just the Euclidean norm. Later on, when people talk about lattices, often what they consider the norm is the norm squared, but we're just going to stick with the norm being the usual Euclidean norm. So one way to tell is to characterize whether these centers with balls with this radius is indeed a sphere packing is just if this energy is 0, because then all the when you apply h of r to any two distinct points in here, they're separated by at least r, and so you get 0. Then the density of such a packing is going to be, we have n points per fundamental cell. Each point is the center of a ball of radius r over 2. And so we get this, and this is a little, I think I like this better than I did previously. So this will be, when we have an n point periodic packing of radius r over 2, or the centers are separated by r, then this is the fraction of space covered by the packing. because each of the balls covers this much for the balls that are in a particular fundamental domain. Okay, just quickly, just now I got a few pictures because it's Friday afternoon. So when lambda is Z2, the covolume is one. The points are separated by one, but the radii are a half. And so our volume is pi over four divided by one. And now if you slide all of these points down, it's clear that the volume decreases that's needed, that they're overall occupying, and you improve by a factor of two over the square root of three, or the reciprocal of one over root three over two. And so this A2 or hexagonal lattice is definitely a denser arrangement of balls in, or discs, circles in two dimensions. But it's a classical theorem of Tuohy, and a rigorous, whether Tuohy had a proof is people discuss. Anyway, there's elegant, nice, rigorous proofs, but non-trivial, you know, clever proofs by Feyerstoff in the 1940s that prove the optimality of the A2 lattice. So the equilateral or A2 lattice, that it's optimal, has been known for some time. Now, we started out with Harriet asking Sir Walter Raleigh. He then corresponded with Kepler, who included a conjecture that the optimal arrangement is given by intertwining hexagonal lattices. This also the face-centered cubic or the cubic close packing. These things go by different names. There are different, there are multiple distinct choices of this, but they all come from, in certain planes, you have A2, and then in the next plane, you have an offset A2. The proof that this is the optimal density, or that the optimal density is pi over root 18, was only very recently proved by Tom Hales, and is really at the edge of what people can really want to consider a human proof. So Tom has moved into automatic proof verification, and his partly motivated by this complicated proof, and the proof has been also automatically verified, but it's very complicated. Not to mention a large computer assisted component. I'll say a little bit about the kissing number. So if you take the collection of shortest vectors in a lattice, so say this is the origin, and then in the A2 lattice, there are six vectors of minimal length. Now for a generic lattice in two dimensions, there will just be two vectors, a one-dimensional subspace given by the two shortest vectors. Or a square lattice, there will be four shortest vectors. Anyway, so the collection of shortest vectors sometimes in the lattices form very nice configurations on the sphere of a one lower dimension. And so we'll see that. They also give what's called a kissing configuration. since these are the shortest distances in the lattice and there's translation invariance, then the distance between these shortest vectors has to be greater than or equal to this shortest distance. And so what's called the kissing number in dimension D is the maximum number of non-overlapping balls of a particular radius that can all simultaneously touch a single ball of the same radius. And so a lattice always gives you a bound, a lower bound for the kissing number, where the important parameter is how many shortest vectors are there in the lattice. So for example, the E8 lattice in eight dimensions is going to be an important object for us. So I want to take just a minute just so you know what it is. This also comes up in algebra, and it's amazing the unity of mathematics. So anyway, it's so this a simple way to understand it is you take Z8, all vectors of length 8 with integer coordinates, and then you also take the translate of Z8 by, you translate it by the centroid of the cube in Z8. So you translate it by 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, the vector of length 8 with all coordinates 1/2. So that's kind of, you take, if you think about Z8 as the vertices of these eight dimensional cubes, then inside of each one, you're going to have another point. Then, okay, so you take all these points and then you add the condition that they sum to an even integer. Okay. So this removes a fraction of them, and that's what E8 is when you're left. And the minimal length vectors, first of all, it's easy to see that the minimal length vectors in Z8 that sum to an even integer, so you have to have at least two non-zero coefficients, and the ones coming from here, from Z8, are of the form there are two non-zero coordinates, and each one can be plus one or minus one. So then the sum is either minus two, zero, or plus two. And it's easy to compute that there are 112 or eight choose two possible choices for where the non-zero coordinates go. And then for each of those, we have four choices of plus minus one in those two places. So there are 112 vectors there. And then the shortest vectors here, the z plus a half to the eight, these vectors are all of the form of an odd multiple of two. So every coordinate's an odd multiple of two. And then of course they all have to add up to an even integer. So it's clear that the least you can do is to have each of the coordinates be plus or minus a half. And there are, and then if you specify the first seven, then the last one is determined by the condition that they sum to an even integer. And so there are two to the seventh such possibilities. And so there are 240 vectors in that inner shell. And all of these vectors, it's easy to compute, have a length, Euclidean length, square root of two. In fact, it will be an important part, I'll mention it later, that all of the distances in the E8 lattice are of the form of the square root of an even integer. And so the fact that the distance set has that nice structure is important in some of the later results we'll talk about. So that, so we'll see linear programming bounds of different types. Really, these originated with work of Delsarte and others, and in particular then Levenstein in the 70s, dealing with coding, people in coding theory. And these are kind of the motivation for linear for the rest of stuff. So in particular, it was shown in 1979 that the kissing configuration you get from the E8 lattice, which gives you a kissing bound of 240, is in fact optimal. So you can't touch more than 240. Okay, I wanted to say a little bit about, so we'll talk about this, then we'll come back, and I'd like to sketch the proof of this. So in 2003, Henry Cohn and Noam Elkies produced this kind of important paper where they took ideas from coding theory, linear programming bounds, to develop bounds for the packing density in Euclidean space, the sphere packing, the optimal sphere packing density in. And it becomes a purely analytic problem. So what you need to do is you produce a function f, and here admissible means that f and f hat have sufficient decay, or f and f hat sufficient smoothness, that Poisson summation formula holds. So I'm, for example, for most of this, in fact, you could assume f is a Schwarz function. Anyway, admissible means f and f hat have sufficient decay. Now, there are various ways of normalizing this result. And so this result is normalized as if all the centers in our configuration are separated by at least r. So we have a sphere packing of radius r over 2. With this, there's a normalization here that says we need f of 0 equal to f hat of 0. Like I said, you could rescale this in various ways. And I think in the Cohn-Elkies paper, in fact, they list at least three versions of this. You need F to be less than or equal to 0, a non-positive outside the ball of radius R. Inside, you don't care. And you need that the Fourier transform is non-negative. And then if you can find an F, and I should have said, I think somewhere I do, an F for and a positive R that satisfy these properties, then that gives you a bound on the packing density. So what could be easier, okay? And so, but what we'll see is that to get, so any such, you know, you can construct many such functions, but in order to show a tight bound or an optimality, it will put very extremely strong conditions on this function f. And in fact, many people will call, if you achieve optimality, then f will be called the magic function. So here is from their 2003 paper, the linear programming bounds, these were precise but numerical, rigorous but, the bounds that the rigorous bounds they got were looked numerically as if they were zero, but analytically could not be extended to there are three curves here. There was an older bound by Rogers, that's the top curve. Then their new upper bound obtained by optimizing F using a particular scheme they had in different dimensions, and then plotting what was. So this middle curve is not an analytic curve, it's a computed curve, but the computations are rigorous. And then the jaggedy curve is, the jaggedy thing is, what are the best known arrangements or packings, what's the best packing density in each of these dimensions. And so it appeared that in 24 these bounds touch almost. In 8 dimensions they do, and in 2 dimensions they do. Well, we already know the optimal packing density in 2 dimensions, and also in 1 dimension. And so it's just interesting in 1 dimension where we can explicitly find the magic function. I should say that in 2 dimensions, no one's been able to find a proof of the dense magic function for A that shows optimality of A2. Although there is a Phaistos, several proofs of that fact. Okay. So anyway, in these special dimensions, these bounds, and in 24 dimensions, there's something called the Leech lattice that was conjectured to be the densest arrangement. In 8 dimensions, this is corresponding to the Leech to the E8 lattice, and in 2 dimensions, the A2 lattice. So here is an optimal configuration for D equals 1. So for D equals 1, I can give 2 magic functions. So I want, it's not hard to check that F at 0 is 1. The integral under here, which is F hat at 0, is also 1. So we satisfy this for this linear B-spline. It's F of X is in fact 0 outside here for X bigger than or equal to 1. So I should say 1 is the value here. F hat of T is the Fourier transform of this is the sinc squared, sorry, which is non-negative. And therefore, we get that delta 1, you can cover the unit line, the real line, with equal balls completely. Fraction of space is 1. There are others, but this is enough right now. And so this is on the archive. And I wanted to, so this is an annals paper, sphere packing problem in dimension 8. And then Marina just won the Fields Medal essentially for this work. So I wanted to say, at least give some idea of this, and then connections to sphere packing, to methods for sphere packing and energy bounds on the sphere that we work with. I should say, okay, so just look at the dates. This is March 14th. And then one week later, March 21st, the group Henry Cohn, Abhinav Kumar, Stephen Miller, Radchenko, and Vyazovska then come out with a joint paper proving the optimality of the Leech lattice. Essentially, there were technical issues that had to be overcome to go to handle the 24, but much of it was, that's why once they all got together, it came out so fast. So I'm gonna just talk about 8. So first let me give the idea of the proof of the own Elkie's bounds, because really the proofs is just a simple application of Poisson summation. First of all, the dual lattice, here are two characterizations of the dual lattice. It's the set of characters. So these are the set of vectors W such that W dot V, this is the Euclidean inner product, lands you back in Z for all vectors V in lambda. That's one characterization. This characterization explains why the dual lattice gives you the frequencies when you do Fourier series for lattice periodic functions. Computationally, the transpose of the inverse or the inverse of the transpose generates the dual lattice. And the dual lattice, here we need the Poisson summation formula, which says that if you have an admissible function f and you sum it over the lattice, then that's also related to this sum over the dual lattice. And so this is a Fourier series result about convergence of Fourier, periodizing your function f. So we'll need that in just a minute. So here's a sketch of the Cohn-Elkies bound, just so you could, because this process is very similar to what we do on the sphere. We're gonna suppose that we satisfy the hypotheses of the Cohn-Elkies bound. So R and F satisfy these relations. And it's sufficient to verify, to prove, to restrict ourselves to general endpoint periodic packings. So if you can show that the density of any endpoint lambda periodic packing is bounded, then the soup over these gives you the same as the soup over general packings. In other words, it's not too hard to verify whatever you can do with a general one, approach that density with a sequence of endpoint lambda periodic packings where N is growing. So what we'll do is establish that in fact the density of a general endpoint lambda periodic packing is given by we want to show this. So we start with, so this is really an energy type proof. So I want to observe that since F is less than, I should have put a constant in here to account for F, the value of F between zero and one, but inside the ball. But anyway, we'll assume that I've adjusted HR by a constant that doesn't affect this proof at all. In any case, for X larger than R, H is zero and F is less than or equal to zero. So what we get is that HR energy of the configuration, which has to be zero in order for this to be a periodic packing is bigger than or equal to the F energy of C. And then the F energy of C can be written as, okay, so we for each I, we're going to take this, and then this double sum accounts for all of the points in the configuration, including, in fact, here, when V is zero and J is I, we are now getting the full configuration. So in order to remove the case where one where this can be equal to XI, we have to subtract off N times F of zero. And so this is the F energy. And by the Poisson summation formula, we're going to apply the Poisson summation formula to this inner sum, because this is a lattice sum. The inner sum becomes this factor. And now interchanging, bringing these finite sums inside, and possibly using the decay of F hat as well here, we get that when we bring F hat out, then this double sum over this becomes a square, becomes the product of this sum with its conjugate. So it's easy to see that this double sum moved in becomes here. So now we get a sum of so this left hand part, this term, F hat is assumed to be non-negative for all W. This guy, of course, is bigger than or equal to zero. And then we still have this minus n f zero. And then here comes the crazy part. We have this sum of non-negative terms. We're going to throw away everything that only involves that involves the actual configuration omega n. So we're going to throw away anything. So we do that by throwing away all the terms in this sum except for W equals zero. So when W equals zero, this becomes inside here, you're adding one up N times. So you get an N squared coming from here when W is zero. You get F hat at zero, since that's the only term here. And then we have this. And then we still have minus n f zero. Now with our normalization, let's see, we can pull out f hat at zero is equal to f at zero. So we can pull this factor out and we get, and that factor, because f at zero is positive, we get that what's left, n over lambda minus one is less than or equal to zero. In other words, we get n over the covolume of lambda is necessarily less than or equal to one. So if you can find a endpoint periodic configuration with where R is, where we scale it so that R is the R used in our from the magic function, then we get this bound. And what's interesting is to see what are conditions that the periodic packing be optimal. So in order for to show the optimality of EA, then it turns out that that's going to, okay, so let's see what happens. So first of all, if we there are two places where there's an inequality, here and here. So from this inequality, we have to have that F vanishes at all of the values coming from differences in the configuration, except for zero. So if you take any two X's in the configuration, and then and then look at the difference vector, so F has to vanish at all of the points, all of these differences occurring in the configuration. We have to have this, that all of these terms that we threw away have to vanish in order to get equality right here. And so in order to show that a particular code is optimal, like the E8 lattice, then we need to have both A and B hold. Now, for when we're in the lattice case, it's a little easier because N is one. When N is one, in fact, that just forces the Fourier transform to vanish at all of the points in the dual lattice except the zero vector. Now, there are a couple of things. Without loss of generality, you may assume that F is a radial function. And I'm going to completely abuse notation and go back and forth between thinking of F sometimes as a function on RD and sometimes as a function on R plus and just go back and forth. In this case, F hat is also radial, but of course the Fourier transform still depends on what dimension you're in. So, here are some reasons. So here's just a sketch of some of the ideas that went into Marina's magic function. First of all, E8 as well as both E8 and the Leech lattice are self-dual and are what is called an even unimodular lattice, which means that the squares of the distances are all of the even integers. So all of these distances appear and that's exactly all of them. And so in order to construct a magic function in either case, you have to have F and F hat vanish at the square roots of even integers. And you also, because we need F hat, we need these bounds, we need F to be non-positive, stay below zero outside of the modulus of X larger than R. We also have to have F prime vanish. We have to have zeros of double order. Well, except at we can have a sign change in F, and in fact, we need to have a sign change in F. So except at the shortest distance at square root of two. So we have double zeros at all of these for F, except at square root of two where we just have a single zero. And then we have double zeros for F hat at all of these values because F hat can't change sign anywhere. And this is a hard condition to, there haven't been a lot of analytical tools for specifying a function at such a function, samples of a function and samples of its Fourier transform at a collection of points. And so how do you use this? And so there have kind of become two ways now. And so let me just outline what Marina did. This is based on the method of Cohn and Elkies They found it convenient because they realized that they were needing these conditions look at F hat plus F and F hat minus F, which are now eigenfunctions of the Fourier transform. Now must still vanish at all of these square roots of 2n. And since F is now involved, there's just a single root that needs to come in at square root of 2, and then double roots for both of these eigenfunctions at all of the other values. And so now, since these are eigenfunctions of the Fourier transform, forcing conditions on 0 in one domain, then also gives it in the other domain. And so Marina, so this is roughly, I'm going to probably say enough to be completely confusing, but the idea was that Marina took was to include this factor in when first constructing these eigenfunctions, and then together with another factor, I'm writing it like this, but really it ends up being an integral over the imaginary plane and will involve functions that are harmonic in the analytic in the upper half plane, and then end up being modular or quasi-modular functions. But this is close enough. And the idea is that when you ask for what function psi will this be an eigenfunction of either plus one or minus one, then when you compute the Fourier transform of this expression, you get functional equations on psi plus and minus that are really the kind of functional equations that come up when studying SL2 modular and quasi-modular functions. So in the end, you end up these functions being modular or quasi-modular. There will be a simple pole that occurs when the norm of X is the square root of 2 that cancels the double zero in here. Oh, this needs to be squared. I'm sorry. This whole function is squared. This is sine squared. Then you need to put these eigenfunctions back together and show that indeed, when you do this appropriately, you get a magic function. So that's way beyond. I'm already seeing I'm running out of time. I would like to say, so a graduate student, Aram Feigenbaum, and I worked with Peter Grabner. Fortunately, Peter is an expert on analytic number theory and such. And so we have, if you want to see some of this construction of eigenfunctions with specified zeros, at least it was written at a level that I could understand. So if I understand it, and we generalize it for to all dimensions that are divisible by 4. Now, I'm not going to, I may have to stop here. Well, let me just see if I got just a tiny bit more. So I would like to say that as we looked at this, this is really about energy bounds, which we then related to packing. And so the group Cohn, Kumar, Miller, Radchenko, and Vyazovska have a paper. It came out in 2019 on the archive, but it's to appear that established that E8 and the Leech lattice are also optimal for a large class of energy problems. And here they use a lot of these techniques, but this part, this eigenfunction part, gets replaced with what are called new Fourier interpolation formulas, where in dimensions 8 and 24, you reconstruct functions is very similar to the Shannon sampling theorem, except now instead of taking samples of F on at some multiples of Z, you are evaluating F and F hat, and in fact, F prime and F hat prime at these points. And then you can reconstruct, for example, Schwartz functions. So this is a really exciting, and this also leads to a simpler construction of Marina's magic function. But okay. Peter, so do you want, I could go 5 minutes or I could stop, just, or
I think 5 minutes is okay, but can you summarize quickly, you know, in 5 minutes, the remainder?
I don't know. Okay, yes, I will do that.
Thank you.
Because we did get started a few minutes late. Yeah.
Right.
So, okay, great. So now we're going to talk about finite configurations on the sphere. And so now our finite configuration will be denoted C. It's called the spherical code. The cardinality is N. We're interested in the distances. And since the distances for points on the sphere can be written in terms of the inner product from this formula, we usually will write now interaction type energies in terms explicitly of the inner product. But you could always go back and think of this as a function, as a radial function restricted to the sphere. We are, of course, interested in finding codes that give for a given H are minimal for the H energy. I'm gonna skip these, except to say, okay, so here are a collection of classical results that were proven using linear programming methods that I'll say maybe a tiny bit about. But I did want to say, I mentioned two of them. This N equals 240 D7, this is the inner shell of the E8 lattice. And this was shown to be optimal for harmonic potential and the logarithmic potential. And in all of these cases, these are what are called sharp codes. Now, a code is sharp if there are k inner products or k distances, distinct distances between points in the code, and this is a spherical 2k minus 1 design, which I need to say, is right here. So a code is a spherical tau design if it, when you average polynomials, multivariate polynomials of degree tau or less, and you average them at this point, then this gives you an exact quadrature for the integral of the polynomial over the sphere. So spherical tau designs have occurred in a bunch of places. Let me just say, and then I will really, because this is going to, that the linear programming bounds are based on this idea that if you have a potential, you want to find a magic function f that has that's positive semi-definite, which means that it has positive expansion coefficients when you write it in terms of Gegenbauer polynomials. So this is like saying that the Fourier transform is non-negative. We get that the F energy of our code is bounded below by this expression. And F zero is the coefficient of the zero, is a zeroth coefficient. And so this is an integral of F. And then F of one over N is a sample of F evaluated at N. So this gives us a lower bound for the energy. And this leads to what's called the Delsarte-Uden linear programming bound. And let me just, finding such Fs in general, so we're usually interested in maximizing this lower bound, and finding such F that maximize that lower bound is often hard. And in particular, if you're trying to show actual optimality, that's really difficult for a particular code. I'm going to skip forward to the following. In work with our team, Boyvalinkov, Dragnev, myself, Saf, and Stoyanova, we develop a theory of universal lower bounds that says if you want to find the best polynomial in of a certain degree, then we use machinery developed by Levenstein to produce the optimal, the magic function that gives you the best value that in that space. Okay, I am going to stop there. So I'll stop there.
Thank you very much, Doug. I'm sure there will be many, many questions, but I can answer them. That's a good one.
So the very last thing Doug said, could you elaborate on that? Is that polynomial? Is that
that's the beauty of being able to be in the room. I can simply draw. So you have these inner products between the special codes. For example, think the icosahedron. Icosahedron, there are three of them, right? So you're here, the first floor, five of them. Then there's another one, five. And then there's the opposite point. So minus one and two more. Icosahedron happens to be a five design. Five design means that you can, get that formula true for all of these polynomials up to degree five. So what you do is you Hermit interpolate here, here, and here, all right, with a polynomial that bounces. Here, even you don't have to interpolate, you can cross. And this is your magic function. Now, if you go to the 600 cell, 600 cell, that's 120 point on S3. And Doug, I'm answering because I can write also on the board.
Oh, Peter, please.
So there, what happens, Doug, do you have by any chance the triangle?
Not a great picture talk, of
that's
it.
Fine. I'll just quickly say the triangle. So the 600 cell has eight such roots. So whatever. So that minus one being one. Now, the issue with the 600 cell, it's only an 11 design. So you can interpolate up to 6 points, right? And that quadrature that Doug refers to gives us six you know, polynomial degree 11 interpolates at 6 points. Not good enough. So we developed a technique because the 600 cell happens to have zero moments, not just up to 11, but also 13, 14, 15, 16, all the way to 19. Just 12 is a bad moment. And moment is really that the Gegenbauer polynomial substituted evaluating the, you know, the code in a product's value. There is a way. So what we have to do is interpolate at 8 points, but skip the 12. Now you toss away a Gegenbauer polynomial of degree 12, and then your Hermite interpolation gets busted. Your quadrature rules get busted. These are usually Radon quadrature, Gauss quadratures, you know, rules of orthogonal polynomials are these rules for the magic function. And we developed a trick that actually does work in this case. And by requiring either the 11th and the 12th polynomials, we skip 11 and 12, but we require a double interpolant and minus one, and whatever the inner products of the 600 cell is, or the 12 and 13. Colin Kumar used 11, 12, and 13, you know, skipped, but they wanted only a single interpolant and minus one. And their proof was way more difficult than ours. We kind of got a triangle of best polynomials of degree 17. You gotta go to degree 17 because you have 16 conditions, interpolation conditions, and you want one, actually two, of the polynomials you took away. 12 is not enough. You have to go 12, 11, or 12, 13. You gotta do two to actually achieve that. So degree 16 polynomial will not be good. But since all of the moments up to 19 are zero, except that 12 moment, you have all. All right. Now the polarization bound that he was talking about, well, he had in the title. So imagine now a square, or not a square, but a cube. So you have a cube in the sphere. Well, that's pretty much what it is. So you have a cube in the sphere, and think of it as light sources. And they emit light. So this is your code that defines a potential. You want to maximize the darkest spot, to place them in a special way. So you gotta find the minimum, where that minimum of that potential occurs. For the cube, the minimum occurs at the spherical caps here. The icosahedron, what happens, we have developed that technique, that magic function technique, for this type of problem, maximizing the minimum of a potential. Okay, and it works even better than the previous one. And if you go to the icosahedron, there, same thing happens like with the 600 cell. You have three zeros for the, you know, that magic function with the Gauss-Jacobi quadrature. But you gotta go to four because there are four distances. And that's what we did in that latest work. So there's more into the story, but you know, it's a very nice that Doug was able to explain to us what a Fields medal work actually takes, right? Thank you, Doug. Thank you again. Any other question? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so just first make sure I understand correctly. So in the pure passage, the reason that that we solved the problem in 8 and 24 was because we got, say, the EA lattice and the H lattice as really nice properties.
Exactly.
Okay. Do you think those are the only two cases with those nice properties, or is there maybe some higher dimension? With a
Someone thinks that 4 might be possible.
Yeah,
want to elaborate why the EA and the Leech lattice are the only ones. And I know that there is work for R4, but I'm not sure. And R2, like you said, there is some work there too. You want to answer the question?
I'll say a little bit. I don't think people, even unimodular lattices are restricted. I don't think that people expect there to be higher dimensions where exactly what happens in 8 and 24 are going to work. In 4 dimensions, the direct linear programming bounds numerically are not going to work, where something called the D4 lattice is conjectured to be the optimal packing. But recently, using I think 3-point bounds, Henry Cohn and I forget who else have a paper that's come out this fall giving a procedure that's related to linear programming that might work. For energy, for us, the biggest is that the hexagonal lattice has not been shown to be optimal for this big class of energy problems. And so it has turned out to be, that's the biggest one open for us. I did want to say, Peter, could I just say this tiny bit about quadrature here? I should have, or no?
Right. That's, go ahead.
Okay, so I did want to say our lower bound that comes out of this linear programming bound, as long as is of this form F0, which is an integral, zeroth coefficient of the Fourier, is this integral minus F1 of n. And so if this F sample of F1 divided by n is part of a quadrature rule that's exact for some collection of functions, say a subspace lambda, then we'll say that this is a 1 over n quadrature rule. And what happens is you change this lower bound that has like a plus and a minus part into now a lower bound, as long as the rho i's, the weights, are non-negative, in terms of something that's monotonic in F. And now the only condition on F is that it stays below H. And so we get that this gives us something that this connects up this lower bound now to quadrature rules. And so this allows us, whenever we have such a quadrature rule, to then find a candidate for the magic function, for the best function in that subspace. Okay, that's all.
Thank you. And I was showing that when, for some magic codes, you can find it coming from the code. And
yeah.
That's the idea. All right. Well, thank you, Doug, again.
Okay. Enjoy.
Thanks, everyone.
Sorry, I can't be there with you.
Okay, let me stop the recording.